Heavenly Father, we thank you for this solemn moment. We thank you for bringing us to the conclusion of this retreat for this year. We bless your name because you are calling us to Christ. You are calling us to follow him and follow him till we get to heaven. We pray that all the grace we need, all the strength we need, all the vigilance we need, all the watchfulness we need, all the sobriety we need, and all the holiness and righteousness we need to get to that final place that will crown our efforts and our journey and our decisions and our convictions. Grant us all we need in Jesus' name. Make us wise, like the wise virgins expecting the bridegroom. And they were ready, prepared until he came. Help us, Lord, that we not be like the foolish virgins who toy with their souls, who gamble with their lives, who are lost forever, even though they could have been saved. Help us, Lord, to follow through what other people do. And help us, Lord, that on the final day we'll hear those wonderful words: come into the joy everlasting, the joy of the Lord your God. Keep us watching, keep us ready until that day. Speak to every heart now. Make us wise unto salvation. In Jesus' name I pray. We thank the Lord for his goodness. I will thank him for bringing us to this final session of this retreat. I will thank the Lord for what he has spoken to us and what he has revealed to us since we began the retreat. We thank him for the corrections he has made. I will thank him for the challenges he has given. We thank him for the word that came in the power of the Spirit from all the ministers the Lord sent to us. And we thank the Lord for those who have recovered all the experiences that were lost, for those who are saved, for those who are restored, and for those who have gone deeper and higher in the Lord. We thank the Lord. We pray that what God has done in our hearts, in our lives, in our families, in the church, and all over this nation and continent and beyond, we pray the Lord will keep it permanent in Jesus' name. As we come to this final session, we're looking at the message, pressing on towards the heavenly home. Pressing on towards the heavenly home. I'm reading from Philippians chapter 3. And we're reading from verse 13. Philippians chapter 3, verse 13. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Here we find Paul the apostle. Since he heard the word of the Lord from Christ himself, that word came from heaven, and he knew there is a place called heaven. And the Lord called his name, Saul, Saul, why persecuted thou me? That voice came from above. He looked up and he said, Lord, who art thou? Who are you? And he said, I am Jesus whom you persecute. From that point on, he knew there is a place called heaven, the place where Christ has gone. and the place from which Christ was calling him. Beyond that, he knew another thing. He said, 14 years ago, I knew a man. Whether in the flesh, I do not know. Or in the spirit, I do not know. But I know that man. He was taken to the third heaven. And he heard things he couldn't repeat. And he saw things he couldn't reveal. He said, of that man will I glory. He's talking about heaven. In fact, he mentioned it's in paradise. And he said, because of that, I know there is heaven. And since that time, his heart had been panting. He had been yearning. He wanted to be there. He tells us in Philippians chapter 1, reading from verse 21, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. He knew that there is heaven, and he knew that if he died, he'll be going to heaven. Then he said in verse 22, but if I live in the flesh, this is the fruit of my labor. Yet what I shall choose, I know not, I wot not. For I am in a strait between two things. He said, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better, reveals to us that if he died, immediately he will be with Christ. What does that mean? His spirit, his soul, the inner man will be with Christ immediately. You see, when a believer dies, his soul, his spirit goes to the Lord immediately. He goes to heaven immediately, but the body is here on earth. On the day of resurrection, is the spirit and the soul in already in heaven that will join with the body here on earth and be resurrected and be glorified. But he knew there is heaven. And because of that, he was pressing on. He said, this one thing I do. I have a desire to depart. I want to be with the Lord. It tells us in Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. He had no doubt at all. Because he knew the reality of heaven. He knew the wonders of heaven. And he said, I want to be there. Philippians chapter 3. It tells us in verse 20. Philippians chapter 3 verse 24. Our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change a vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself. Well, in your heart, there should be no doubt. There's a place called heaven. You remember when Stephen was going to die? He looked up to heaven and he saw Jesus Christ. And he said, I see Jesus is standing at the right hand of the Father. And while they stoned him, he said, Lord, receive my spirit. His spirit went to heaven immediately. The body was here for the believers to bury. That's why Paul the apostle now says in Philippians chapter 3, reading from verse 14, I press toward the mark of the prize for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Pressing on towards the heavenly home. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, I'm reading from verse 1. Those who are pressing on, those who realize there is a heaven to gain, there is a hell to shun, there is a glory to gain, there is a suffering to avoid, there is a wonder to obtain, and there is a hellfire to escape, and there is a beauty everlasting, the joy everlasting, the reward everlasting. There is something eternal and everlasting to obtain, and there is something everlasting to you, the fire, the suffering, the agony, and the pressure, and the regret everlasting to avoid. Those who know that, they are pressing on. and they're pressing on in such a way that all encumbrances and all hindrances and all evil things that will tie them down, they shed it off. Hebrews chapter 12, reading from verse 1. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. What does that mean? A cloud of witnesses that lived here on earth, but now they are in heaven. That knew that there's a better country. There's a more glorious country. There's a heavenly country that the Almighty God Himself has prepared for His own. And they're longing for, and they're pressing towards, and they want that country by all means. And the Bible says, if they had had any desire to have gone back to where they came from, they could have had the chance. But now they testify and declare, there is a better country whose foundation is made by God Himself. That's why these people, now they become like a cloud of witnesses for us. And it says, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, the witnesses of those who endured here on earth, and they pressed on until they got there, like Abraham, like Abel, like Enoch, like Noah, and like Sarah, and like Ruth, and like Moses, and like all those Israelites were told about in Hebrews chapter 11. Those clouds of witnesses that they pressed on until they got there. He says, now it's come to your turn. Now this is your chance, because you have seen this cloud of witnesses. Let us lay aside. You cannot press on until you lay aside all the things that will hinder you. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so doth easily beset us. Habitual sin. Besetting sin. The one you'll be falling into over and over before you came to this retreat. The one that brings sorrow in your heart. The one that you always get back to. The temptation came, you couldn't overcome. It says, lay that aside and press on and have something glorious and something wonderful in front of you. It says, the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him. Always have that before you. The heavenly goal, the heavenly dream, the heavenly desire, the heavenly possession. Have that before you. The joy that is set before you. That's what Jesus did. And he set his face like a flint. He knew he was going somewhere. Do you know you are going somewhere? And do you know that the Lord expects you? You will press on, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself. Sinners will try to discourage you. They will try to distract you. They will try to depress you. They will try to send you back. They'll try to make you shift your focus and shift your mind and shift your aspiration and shift your desires and shift your dream and shift your goal. The sinners will try. They will try to contradict what is uppermost in your heart. They will try to dissuade you, and they will try to make a substitute. They'll try to show you something, something different from what you're looking for. It says, at such a time, remember you are pressing on towards something, your heavenly home. It says, consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. Ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. He said, you might have to even lay down your life, fighting against sin, contending against evil, contending against backsliding. It might have to be at the price of your blood. He said, you are not there yet. Keep on striving and keep on contending and keep on pressing on until you get to that heavenly home. We'll be there in Jesus' name. Are you there? I say, we'll be there in Jesus' name. Pressing on. Every day, pressing on. Every moment, pressing on. During the retreat, pressing on. After the retreat, pressing on. In your place of work, pressing on. Anywhere you find yourself, pressing on towards the heavenly home. And you're making progress every day. And you're getting nearer and nearer every day. This is not the time to let down. This is not the time to slow down. This is not the time to look back. Because we're almost there. If there's anything you ought to do today, is to press on. Your body may not want you. You talk to your body, press on. Your surrounding and people around you, if you're so tied to them, they may be slowing down. And they may be slowing you down. Cut the cord between you and such people. Press on. And it may be that even your own nature, you may not be the pressing type. You may be the sluggish type. You take things easy. There's not the time. If a house is burning and you need to run out, you cannot say, I'm not a runner, I'm not an athlete, I'm never in a hurry. That's the time to get up. The world is going to burn. And it says, if there is any time at all for you to sum up your courage and for you to say everything within you, you bring to the fore and you have to press on, this is the time. Pressing on towards the heavenly home. There are three things we're going to consider. Number one, single-minded pursuit of the heavenly home. Single-minded pursuit. No other thing you are thinking about. No other thing you are planning for. And there is no other alternative. You don't have any other alternative. You say that heavenly home, I must be there. You have a single-minded pursuit of the heavenly home. Number two, sinful passion driving men towards a horrible hell. Sinful passion, sensual passion, careless passion, evil passion, driving people towards a horrible hell. Number three, steadfast perseverance with heart holiness. Steadfast perseverance with heart holiness. That's what it's going to take. You have to persevere. Discouraging sounds are coming. You have to persevere. There's no sights I see. You have to persevere. Different thoughts are coming. You have to persevere. Steadfast perseverance with a heart of holiness. Holiness of heart. Number one, single-minded pursuit of the heavenly home. There's a heavenly home, and we need to pursue whatever happens around us, whatever people think about it, whatever people do for us or do against us. Pursue. We're looking at Acts chapter 7, verse 55. Acts chapter 7. And I'm reading here from verse 55, but he, talking about Stephen, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly into heaven. Looked up steadfastly into heaven. He saw heaven before he died. He saw the glory before he died. There was an assurance within him. There's a place called heaven, the heavenly home, before he died. And we're told he looked up steadfastly into heaven. And he saw the glory of God. He saw the glory. He saw the beauty. He saw the wonder. He saw all that the heart would desire. He saw that before he died. There are many people that have not seen that. They have not seen it in scripture. They have not seen it in vision. They have not seen it in dream. They have not seen it in imagination. They have not seen it in their thoughts. They have not seen it in their lives. That's why they are careless. That when you see that glory, when you see that beauty, when you see that heaven, when you read the scriptures and you believe there's a place called heaven, you will want to press on. And we're told he saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God. And he said, behold, I see. They didn't see, but he said, behold, I see. They didn't think about that, but he said, behold, I see. I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. And then in verse 59, and the stone Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. He had a single-minded pursuit. He said, I've seen heaven. I've seen the glory. I've seen my Jesus. He's standing at the right hand of the Father, wanting to welcome you. And he became steadfast. And all the stones they threw at him, all that did not matter anymore. When you see the glory, and when you see that heavenly home, all the things they do, all the things they say, whatever they act, whatever it is, will not matter to you anymore. There will be a single-minded pursuit of that heavenly home that you see. Look at Luke chapter 9 and see the attitude of Jesus, and see the attitude you ought to have. Well, you know, there's a new Jerusalem. There is a heavenly Jerusalem. There is a glorious city whose foundation is made by God himself. Well, you know, there is an eternal, everlasting, glorious heavenly home for you to get to. Your mind will be there. Your heart will be there. Everything within you will be driving towards that point. In Luke chapter 9, reading from verse 51. And it came to pass, when the time was come, that he should go, that he should be received up, he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem. It wasn't Jerusalem that was the final destination, it was heaven. I'm going back to the Father. He told his own disciples, I said, I'm going back to the Father, and you appear sorrowful. You should have been happy. He should have been happy. He was thinking about the glory he had with the Father from all eternity. He was thinking about the worship of all those angels and the sight of all those angels before he came to the world. He was thinking of the beauty of heaven, the peace in heaven. He was thinking about the joy in heaven. He was thinking about how all those myriads of angels will welcome him. And he steadfastly set his face to be received up, going through Jerusalem. That's how you set your face. That's how you set your mind. That's how you set your focus. That's how you set your life. That's how you pursue with single-mindedness, knowing there's a place called heaven and you want to be there. Look at Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, and I'm reading from verse 22. There's a place called heaven. Innumerable angels are there, and great joy is there. Hebrews chapter 12, reading from verse 22. In verse 22, but here come unto Mount Zion and unto the city of the living God. Stop right there. Unto the city of the living God. Think about that. The eternal God, the city where he lives, that's called heaven. Unto the city of the living God. And there's no evil there. There's no sin there. There's no sickness there. There's no suffering there. There's no night there. Everything is light. Everything is glory and glorious. Everything is wonder and wonderful. Everything is joy and joyful. Everything is peace and peaceful. It says it's the city of the living God. And that's where we're going. And when you think about that, and you compare this world with heaven, and you compare this country with the heavenly country, and you compare all the things you could have here, you compare that with the glorious land, your mind will leave this place and your mind will not be here. All you want to do is, what can I do to add to my joy when I get there? What can I do to add to my reward when I get there? What can I do to add to my appreciation of God when I get there? It says it is a heavenly city where God himself is living, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and the church of the firstborn, which are written in heaven. You want to make sure that your name is there. You want to make sure that there's a record for you and a record concerning you in heaven. You want to make sure that your name is already gone before you, so that now you are coming, and as you get to the gate, they check the register of heaven. They say, his name is there, her name is there, and then the angels will welcome you. Your mind should be thinking of that. That should be your pursuit. Single-mindedly saying, that's where I'm going. That's where I want to be. I pray you'll be there in Jesus' name. And that's why it says in Colossians chapter 3, single-minded pursuit. Single-minded pursuit. After, or through, or towards this heavenly home. In Colossians chapter 3, Colossians chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 1. If ye then be risen with Christ, if you are born again, if ye then be risen with Christ, something happened before you are risen with Christ. Crucified with Christ. I am crucified with Christ. Not only that, you are dead with Christ. Not only that, you are buried with Christ, and now you are risen with Christ. One, crucified with Christ. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. And yet, not I, but the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. You cannot be risen with Christ until the self nature is crucified, until that inbred nature is crucified. But now you're crucified with Christ, and then you have died with him. The world is not important so much to you, and all the things in the world, they're not of interest to you. You are dead to them. You are dead to their smoking. You are dead to their drunkenness. You are dead to all their festivities. They do not attract you, as those things do not attract a dead man. Crucified with him, dead with him, and then you are buried with him. You've gone through that water of baptism. You are immersed in the water. It's a burial that it demonstrates there. You are buried with him, and now you rise in newness of nature. You rise in newness of life. And it says, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. Seek those things which are above, instead of concentrating your life on seeking the mundane things of this life, instead of concentrating your life on seeking the things that will vanish away, and the things that will soon perish, and the things that will be burnt in fire eventually. Seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affections on things above. Like you set a wristwatch, set your affections on things above. Like you set a compass to face just one direction, set your affections on things above. Set your mind, redirect your mind, turn your mind. Let it point at heavenly things. Let it point at things that will last forever. You set your affections on things above. Check up in your life. Is there somebody you set your affection on? You love him so much that it will be so painful for you to divide or to separate yourself from him, and yet it's the one that is leading you in the direction of perdition and suffering and hell. Get your mind away from that and reset your mind, and set your mind on things above. Is there a woman that has so arrested your heart, arrested your soul, captured your life and you set your affection on that woman, and if that woman, once that woman begins to cry, then you cannot take your stand anymore and says, you are leaving me. If you leave me, I will die. If you leave me, if we don't continue this relationship, then that means my life is over. I will write a note and I will say, so and so is the one that caused my death. I will commit suicide. And because of that, you are attached to sin, attached to fornication, attached to adultery. You get your mind away from that woman. Don't let her take you to hell. It says you will set your mind on things above, and you will. Then that's what the Lord wants us to do. Instead of, you know, you're a jellyfish, you don't have a strong mind, you don't know where you are going, you don't know the condition that she's going to get you to heaven, and you do not know what those people are doing, it makes you so attached to them, associated with them. You don't have a free mind, and you cannot say, this is where I am going. But you come today and you say, enough is enough. I am going to get to heaven. Somebody there is going to get to heaven. I said, somebody there is going to get to heaven. You're going to take your heart from them. You're going to take your affection from them. You're going to take your destiny from them. You're going to take your interest from them. You know, if I don't see him in a day, it's like I'm dying. They say, what do I have on earth if I don't see her? What do I have on earth if I don't see him? That's the danger. That's the trap. That's the trap. And you take your mind away from those things that are so essential to you, indispensable to you, and say, now I set my affection on things above and not on things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is seen with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. That's what the Lord is calling us to. That's what the Lord is telling us, and he's saying, you must do something steadfastly. You set your affection steadfastly. You're looking towards that goal and towards the place you're going. That's how to get there. And because, you know, there is something beyond the grave. There's something beyond this world. Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 7. It says, but what things were gained to me, those things I counted loss for Christ. That's a single-minded man. That's a person pursuing something. He said, I count them, number one, I couldn't do without that before. Number two, I couldn't live without that before. I will feel empty. I will feel life is over. I will feel there's nothing to live for on earth if I didn't have that thing. They were gain to me. They were profitable for me. They were essential for me. They were almost indispensable to my existence. It may be a small thing. It may be a big thing. Something that has held your heart, captured your heart, captured your life. And everything, every time you think, you're saying, I thank God I have that. I thank God I have that. If I didn't have that, how would I live? If I didn't have that, how would I ever be joyful? Paul the apostle said, that thing was making me look downwards. That thing was making me look at sand and cement. That thing was attaching me to the things on this earth. They were profitable, and they were gain to me. He said, because now I see the glory, because now I see that heaven, because I see where I am going very clearly, I jettisoned them, I threw them away. He said, but the things, what things were gain to me, those I counted loss for Christ. You know, sometimes it's an illiterate girlfriend, so-called. Sometimes it's a brute of a man that doesn't even have any fine knees at all that captures your interest. Sometimes it's a stranger you are meeting for the first time, and that person is giving you, showing you things that glitter, but they are not gold. Sometimes it's a position, it's not even in your hand yet, and they are promising you that political position, and then they say, but before you have this, you must go through some rituals. Before before you have this, you must go through some occultism. Before you have this, you must change your religion. And that position becomes so great to you, you've not even got it yet. It's not in your hand yet. And the sin is going to take you from heaven. And Paul the apostle said, but what things were gain unto me, those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things. I count all things. Things of the past, things of the present, things of the future. I've made up my mind already. When they come, I say, no, they're done, they're dross, they're useless, they're worthless. I know what I want. I know where I'm going. I know what I'm going to get. It says, doubtless, I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things. He said, but no regrets, no remorse, no going back. He said, I'm not regretting that. The position I had was the Sanhedrin. Voluntarily, I gave it up. The position I had in the religion of my forefathers, voluntarily, I gave it up. The position I had with traditionalists. Paul the apostle said, no big deal, I've given it up. Have you given anything up? Are they so important to you that they are tying you down? Are they so important to you, you cannot make up your mind, you cannot pursue heaven? All these things that will perish with time, they're so important to you. Paul the apostle said, not me, not me. I count them as loss for Christ. I've suffered the loss of all things, and don't count them, but don't, that I may win Christ. That's a pursuit, single-minded pursuit towards that heavenly home. You know, sometimes you don't know how your life is going to be, whether you have long time or short time. But at this your age now, if you were to have something already, and some of us have been born again now for 20 years, for 30 years, for 40 years, for 50 years. And when you were first born again, you threw away all those things. And your people knew. The villagers knew. Your townspeople knew. That man, that woman, only for heaven. At this age, after 20 years of being in Christ, the things that you have dropped, the things that held no hold upon your life, and the things that, even though the people in the country is important, politics or any other thing, the things you jettisoned and rejected before, at this age now, you're picking it up again. Is that not backsliding? Are you not going back to your vomit? Are you not going back to the thing you said no to many years ago? But Paul the apostle said, when I say goodbye to anything, anybody that brings that thing back, I tell him, don't you know who I am? My constitution, my conviction, my consecration, my devotedness to the Lord. I said bye-bye 20 years ago. 20 years have come and gone. I still say that same thing, bye-bye, because I have counted them as dung and dross and refuse, and I'm not going to go back to them again. That's the mind God wants you to have, so that that heavenly home, you will get there. I said that heavenly home, you will get there. But if your life is all surrounded by this, you don't even know where to put your feet. You don't know how to move around, because this one is there, this one is there, that one is there. Whatever message you are hearing, it will not do anything at all in the positive. You might cry, you might shout, get rid of these things. Come out of this place and get out of those things that will tie you down, and be able to say, like Paul the apostle, I have counted them as dung and as dross. You might have to change your friends. You might have to change your associates. You might have to lock up yourself and say, no, I am not going to give in to that. I heard of a woman. She was about to get married, And this woman knew that the man she was to get married to was not the proper person, a criminal. But she had so much attachment to this man that every time she will say, I cannot marry this man. I cannot marry this man. I will not marry this man. And anytime, even after she has said that, the man will show up again. And once the man shows up, and she sees him like this, all the decisions they are taking, everything will be evaporated. And then she will not know what to say. The man was so captivating for her. And eventually they went on and set the day for the wedding. And the day for the wedding was coming like this. And she was saying, I cannot marry this man. I shouldn't marry this man. If I get hooked up with this man, my life is lost and wasted forever. And then a day to the wedding, everybody was expecting where it was going to take place. She ran to the police station. She said, do me a favor, lock me up in the prison until I tell you to release me. They said, why? He said, I need to get away from something that will destroy my life. I don't have the boldness. I don't have the courage. I don't have the ability to get away from that man. Lock me up. And they locked her up in the prison. And on the wedding day, she was in the prison voluntarily. After the wedding day, she was in the prison voluntarily until the man gave up, and then she came out of the prison and she was free. That woman was not necessarily a Christian. She just knew, I shouldn't marry this man. Can you lock up yourself like that? All those friends are coming, and then you are taking decisions during this retreat, and they will come again and introduce this and introduce that, and you do not have the power, the courage, and you do not have the strength to overcome. Can you lock up yourself in your own room? And can you lock up yourself in your own house? Can you put up that phone? And can you just make sure that they are not able to get to you? That's what Paul the apostle would have done. Because he had a steadfast mind, and he set his affections on things on high. And he said, everything I got in this retreat, I will not lose it. I know how I lost what I got in the past. I'll just be able to come and say this and say that. This time, I will not lose what I've got. I'm talking to somebody. I said, I will not lose what I've got. I said, I will not lose what I've got. You're not losing it in Jesus' name. It's going to take steadfast pursuit or single-minded pursuit after the heavenly home. Number two, sinful passion driving men, driving people towards a horrible hell. There is a hell. Jesus spoke about hell more than any other preacher in the Bible, Old Testament or New Testament. He spoke about hell. From Matthew, he began to tell the people, Matthew chapter 8. In Matthew chapter 8, I'm reading here from verse 11. Matthew chapter 8, we're reading from verse 11. And I say unto you that many shall come from the east and from the west, and shall sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the children of the kingdom, the Jews, the children of the kingdom, the churchgoers, the children of the kingdom, the nominal Christians, the children of the kingdom, the religious people who are not righteous, the children of the kingdom shall be cast out into outer darkness, and there shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. That's Jesus speaking about hell. There's a hell to shun. There's a hell to avoid. There's a hell to escape. And look at chapter 45, Matthew chapter 45, chapter 25, verse 41. Matthew chapter 25, I'm reading from verse 41. Then shall he say unto them, on the left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. Depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. The same eternal hell prepared for the devil is where sinners will go. And think of the suffering, it will be unbearable. If a place that is supposed to make Satan, to make the devil feel the pangs and the punishment and the pain and the horror and the terror, if the place is for Satan and is to make Satan feel the suffering, and any human being is also there with that Satan and with the demons, think of the pain those who get there will feel. Look at verse 46, and these shall go into everlasting punishment. Hell is a place of everlasting punishment. Mark chapter 9. In Mark chapter 9, we're reading from verse 43. And if thy hand offend thee, cut it off. Those who are steadfastly minded to get to heaven, and they say, at all costs, whatever happens, that hell, I will not get there. That means those are the people that know there's a burning hell, there's an eternal hell, there's an everlasting hell, there's a place of everlasting punishment, and they're making up their minds and they're saying, I will not get there, I will not get there. And therefore, whatever they will have to do so that they will not get to that hell, they said, I'm ready to do it. Anybody as important to me as my right hand, if it's going to cause me to get to hell, I cut him off. Anybody as dear, as precious to you as your right eye, if it's going to make you to get to hell, you say, I'm not going to get to hell for you. I'm not going to get to hell loving you and being attached, having affection for you. I will cut you off. That's what the Lord is saying. Look at that verse 43. And if thy hand offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter into life maimed than having two hands to go into hell, into the fire. Ah, there's fire in hell. Did somebody say there's no fire in hell? That's a mistake. That's not right. That's wrong. There is fire in hell. Jesus said, into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where the worm dies not and the fire is not quenched. And if thy foot offend thee, means of transportation, means of movement, you know, it's like your leg, so important to you as your leg. Without him, you cannot get to where you need to go. Maybe he supplies the money for the transportation, maybe he gives the car for the transportation, but when you are in the car together, you know what he does? You're a lady, while you're sitting there together in the front, you know, all the caressing and all the things, and you're saying in your mind, this is not right, this is not right, but I can't resist him. Because the one is my feet, is the one that gives me motion, is the one that gives me transportation. If I tell him now that I don't like this, I don't want this, I want to go to heaven, he will frown what he eat and he will say, are you calling me a sinner? I need to do something about these. All these things that, you know, will influence your life. Little drops of water make a mighty ocean. You fall here, you fall there, you fall there. Are you going to rise? Are you going to take your stand and make sure that you are a pilgrim, you are a candidate for heaven? That's why it says, if thy foot offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter into life than with one hand or with one foot, than having two feet to be cast into hell, into the fire. Hell is a place of burning, it's a place of fire, it's a place of suffering. That's what Jesus said, fire that never shall be quenched, where the worm dies not and the fire is not quenched. And even an eye, what can I do without that eye? What can I do? It's the person that makes me to see. It's the person, he sees a lot of things for me. He gives me information. And the things I wouldn't see ordinarily, he is the one that makes me to see. That's your eye. And he stands for you anywhere. And he goes for you anywhere. And makes you see what you will not see. If that eye, somebody as precious to you as your eye, as important for you as your eye, as needful to you as your eye. If thine eye offend thee, block it out. It's not talking of your natural eye. It's talking about that person. That person so close to you, so precious to you. I cannot live, I cannot go anywhere without him. She is the one, he is the one that sees everything I don't see. If thine eye offend thee, block it out. It is better for thee to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than having two eyes to be cast into hell fire, into hell fire. You see what the Lord is saying? He's saying it's a place of everlasting punishment, and because of that, you want to avoid it by all means. You want to shake it off by all means. There are sinful passions that lead people there, and you want to make sure that by the grace of God, all those sinful passions, all those sinful activities, you are not involved with them. I'm reading from Revelation chapter 14. Revelation chapter 14, I'm reading from verse 10. Revelation chapter 14, and we're reading from verse 10. Revelation 14, verse 10. The same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And ye shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lord. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever. And they have no rest, day nor night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. Revelation chapter 20 from verse 11. And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was no place found for them. And I saw the dead, small and great. I saw the dead, small and great. I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. Hold on. What does this mean? When somebody dies, like the story of the rich man, he died. When he died, immediately his spirit, his soul went to hellfire. But the body was still here on earth. And the body was buried. We're told the rich man died also and was buried. And then he found himself, his spirit and his soul, in hell. And he lifted up his eyes and he saw Abraham afar off. And he said, Father Abraham, send Lazarus to me to just cool my tongue with a drop of water, because I am tormented. Where? In this flame. There's fire there. That's where the spirit and the soul goes immediately a sinner dies. Immediately a backslider dies. Immediately a false prophet dies. A false teacher. That's where they go immediately. The spirit, the soul, they go there to hell. But the body is still here and is buried. And then on the day of resurrection, the power of God will raise that body, and the soul and the spirit that had been in hell since that man died will join to the body, and then spirit, soul and body, the complete man, will now go to the lake of fire. Hell has fire. There's burning, there's suffering, there's agony, there's darkness in hell fire. And it's the spirit and the soul that is there now on this day, great white throne judgment. The spirit and the soul and the body will now join together. And it says death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. What that means is that death and hell cast in lake of fire, nobody will be dying anymore, because all those who go to that lake of fire, they'll be there forever and ever and ever. Suffering, eternal suffering, Everlasting suffering is a place of suffering. They cannot come out of that place. And that's what it says in verse 15. And whosoever a churchman, whosoever a churchwoman, whosoever a backslider, whosoever a sinner, whosoever an idol worshiper, whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. That's why the Lord is saying that you do everything possible, if you have not repented, to turn away from sin and to say a final forever bye bye to sin. And whatever is happening, you set your mind, you set your heart on that heavenly home, and you say, this hell, I will not be there. Listen to me, there are people that play with their souls. You steal now, and you know that the thieves will get to hell. And then after stealing, what if you had an accident and died without a chance of repentance? There are people, when they're sick, because I am sick, there's nobody to pray for me. My people are saying they will carry me somewhere, and they carry you to the idol shrine. And then while you are there in the idol shrine, you die there. You will go to hell. Why don't you endure? Even if you're sick, even if you are suffering, even if you are not healed, the suffering of sickness cannot be compared with the suffering of hellfire. That sickness, even if you are not healed, you will die. And when you die, you are free from that sickness. But if you are carried to the idol shrine, if you are carried to a place of occultism, where they say they are praying and they are throwing this and splashing this on you, and you die there, no matter who buries you, you will go to hell. It's hellfire. That's the reason why you say, whatever happens, whatever I go through, whatever the suffering, whatever the need. Maybe you are barren, and because you are barren, they say come here, they say come there, and they take you somewhere to give you something to eat, mark your body, rub this on you. What's that? That's idol worship. What's that? That's occultism. What's that? You're serving the devil right there, because you're looking for children. If you die there, or if you die on your way back, and you don't have a chance to repent, you will go to hell. That's why you're saying, whatever price it will take, and whatever I need to give up, whatever, in whatever condition I need to remain, I'm going to remain, because that heaven, I will not miss it. I said that heaven, I will not miss it. Somebody there, that heaven, I will not miss it. You will not miss it in Jesus' name. We're looking at point number three, steadfast perseverance with heart holiness. Steadfast perseverance with the holiness of heart. We're looking at Psalm 24. Psalm 24, I'm reading from verses 3 and 4. Psalm 24, we're looking at verses 3 and 4. The word of God tells us, who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who shall stand in his holy place? He that has clean hands and a pure heart. He that has clean hands. Somebody stealing church money, you don't have clean hands. Money is nothing. The church does not become poor because you stole church money, but you are the one that will go to hell. He that has clean hands, the one that is touching other people's daughter, immorality. I didn't go into what are you talking about? I didn't do the real thing. What are you talking about? I only put my hand there, put my hand there. You will perish. He that has clean hands, your hands are not clean. Those who commit abortion, your hands are not clean. You shed innocent blood. I don't want another child. This one came by mistake. We already have 5, 6, 7 children, and this one came by mistake. I'm going to kill this one. You have right to take life. You have right to destroy that baby. You don't have clean hands. If you don't repent, you will perish. And the people that are signing something in your office, they bought it for 2 million. You have to sign 5 million so that the 3 million extra you can share. Your hands are not clean. If you're going to get to heaven, it says, who shall ascend to the hill of the Lord? Who shall stand in his holy place? Did he that has clean hands and a pure heart? A pure heart. Imagining evil against anybody. Look at that man. He just got a new car. If he falls now and dies now, he will see. The people who say he's a rich man, running after him, they will see. Is that a pure heart? That person, he offended me. Look, insult, insult. Look at that fellow. Talking to me like that. If something will happen to him now, and maybe he'll be blind, he'll be paralyzed, and then he will know that what he has done to me, he should not offend a person like me. That's a pure heart. All the evil imagination in the heart, evil suggestion from the heart, and all the thoughts of evil. Look at that woman. I'm not sure whether she's married or not. If I had a chance to do something with her, to commit something, you've not done it. You're thinking about it. Imagination. Is that pure heart? Getting to heaven requires salvation that gives you clean hand. Getting to heaven requires sanctification that gives you a pure heart. And you will not imagine evil, plan evil in your heart. In the night, you appear to be sleeping, and then you are imagining, when I get up, when I wake up, maybe I'll have a chance to do this, to go here, to go there, to touch that, to touch that. And those things are not right. Those things are evil. That's not a pure heart. You want to come to the Lord, and you want to say, whatever other people think about sanctification, about holiness, whether they take it serious or not, you want to get to heaven. He that has clean hands and a pure heart, if they give you money they have stolen, you say, please let me die of poverty, I don't need that money. If they tell you, I got this one, I can help you, you don't want to steal, you don't want to take whatever belongs to whatever, but you know, I'm clever, they will not see me, take this. If you take it, something stolen from other people, you have clean hands and a pure heart, you say, no, I don't need that. But you are hungry, let me die of hunger, I don't need that. If we're going to get to heaven, he that has clean hands and a pure heart, and then it says, who has not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. Holy heart, holiness of heart, that's what it takes for us to get there. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, and I'm reading here from verse 14. Hebrews chapter 12. And we're reading from verse 14. Hebrews chapter 12 verse 14, here is what it says. It says, follow peace with all men. Don't follow strife, fighting. What are you fighting for? Something that will not last for eternity. What are you fighting for? What are you striving for? What are you quarreling about? Have you lost your conviction? Have you lost your vision? Don't you know you are going somewhere? Is this thing so important to fight about? All these things of the world, all the things that will perish your time, is it so important to fight about these things and then plunge yourself into hell, fighting, striving? No, follow peace with all men, and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. God is no respecter of persons. We don't get to heaven by preaching. We don't get to heaven by singing. We don't get to heaven by playing musical instruments. We don't get to heaven by being a worker in the church. We don't get to heaven by being a member of any church, even of Deeper Life. But the peace of God in your heart, that you follow peace with all men, with your manager, with your director in the place of work, whatever they do, they didn't know how to strive, they didn't know how to quarrel, they didn't know how to fight, they just want to go your way. Your in-laws, they'll try to cross trouble, and they will say a lot of unprintable words against you. You are the one wanting to get to heaven, and you are the one that will be saying, I cannot hold malice, animosity in my heart. Look at what they're doing. Look at how I'm suffering in this place, and this is my husband. All those in-laws, they'll try to get you into conflict. Or if you are, maybe you are married, and you're married to somebody who had children before. Maybe he lost his first wife and now he married you. The children can cause trouble, and you know they'll say, this one's come to take the place of our mother, and they do a lot of things. And you're married to that man, and they will try to get you into conflict. You are the one wanting to get to heaven. You are the one to say, I will follow peace with all men. You come to the church here, you see now, you get up there, and then you go to see another, get up there, you go to another, get up there. What's the matter? This is church. What have I done to this person? Did he hear something about me? Why are they hunting me about like this? You are the one to follow peace with all men. The one that wants to cause trouble, wants to fight, and he wants to drag you into argument. He has his own goal. He has his own purpose. You are the one to follow peace with all men. Follow peace with all men. If you want to get to heaven, this is your choice. And holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. I pray we'll get there. I said, I pray we'll get there. When we get there, we'll forget all our sorrows, we'll forget all our tears, we'll forget all our struggles, we'll forget all the things we went through. The joy of heaven, 5 minutes in heaven, you will forget 50 years of suffering. 5 minutes in heaven, you will forget 100 years of trouble here on earth. That's the reason why you don't want to play with your soul. You want to say, I will pay the price. Whatever other people do, I count the cost, and I'm willing to pay whatever it will take. I will get to heaven. You will get there in Jesus' name. We're looking at Revelation chapter 7. Revelation chapter 7. Many people eventually will be there. I pray that God will count you among the number that will be there in Jesus' name. We're looking at it from verse 9. After this, I beheld, and lo, a great multitude which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes, and palms in their hands. White robes, that's their righteousness. White robes, that's their holiness. White robes, that is their sanctification. White robes, that's the nature of God and the life of Christ in them, and palms in their hand. That's a victory. That's a joy. That's a reward. And that is the everlasting happiness that comes to them, and cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb. And all the angels stood round about the throne, and about the elders and the four living creatures, the beasts, and fell before the throne on their faces, and worshiped God, saying, amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be unto our God forever and ever. And everybody said, amen. And one of the elders answered, saying unto me, what are these? Who are these which are arrayed in white robes? And from and whence came they? And I said unto him, sir, thou knowest. And he said unto me, these are they which came out of great tribulation. Not the great tribulation. They came out of great trial, out of great trouble, out of great torment, out of great temptation. But you overcame. You will overcome. I said you will overcome. No matter how great the trouble may be. And you're almost giving up, because you know, I'm still going back to that same home, and that those my neighbors, they're going to do this and that. Face them with courage. Understand, that's the only suffering you will have. When you pass through that suffering, everything is over. And then you cross to the other side, there'll be no more tears, there'll be no more sorrow, there'll be no more pain, there'll be no more death, because all those things are gone away. And he says, behold, I make all things new. And you will rejoice in the presence of God, in the presence of the holy angels, in the presence of the Savior, of Christ your Savior. go through, and the Lord will reward you on the final day in Jesus' name. It says, and they have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, since they are saved, therefore, since they are sanctified, therefore, since they have overcome, therefore, since they have now crossed over to the other side, therefore, are they before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them. We will dwell with God, he will dwell with us. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst anymore. Neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them, and they and shall lead them unto the living fountains of waters. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. I said I will be there. Revelation chapter 19, I'm reading from verse 7. Revelation 19 verse 7. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him. For the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife, his bride, has made herself ready. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. For the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. And it says unto me, write, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And it says unto me, these are the true sayings of God. Chapter 21 of Revelation. Revelation chapter 21 verse 4. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, neither crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat on the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these things are true and faithful. And he said unto me, it is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life. And he that overcometh temptation, and he that overcometh the pressure of people around us, and he that overcometh the challenges that the world may throw at you, he that overcometh, he overcomes the evil nature, the carnal nature, the depraved nature, and is on this side victorious, holy and pure. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. But the fearful, the unbelieving, and the abominable, and it says the murderers, those who commit abortion too, and the whoremongers, and the sorcerers, and the idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Chapter 22, Revelation chapter 22, and we're looking at it from verse 4. It says in verse 3, and there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. Verse 4, and they shall see his face, and his name shall be in their foreheads, and there shall be no night there. And they need no candle, neither the light of the sun, for the Lord God giveth them light, and they shall reign. How long? It shall reign forever and ever. And he said unto me, these sayings are faithful and true. And the Lord God of the holy prophet sent his angel to show unto his servants the things which must shortly be done. Behold, I come quickly. Blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book. It tells us in verse 12, it tells us, behold, I come quickly. My reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life, and may enter in through the gate into the city. I will enter in. You will enter in. Saved, you will enter in. Sanctified, you'll enter in. Following peace with all men, you'll enter in. And holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Counting all the things of this world that want to distract you or destroy you or defile you, you count them as dung and you throw them away. Those are the people that will enter. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. For without outside are dogs and sorcerers and whoremongers and murderers and idolaters and whatsoever loveth and maketh a lie. I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David. I am the bright and the morning star. The spirit and the bride say, come. And then it says, and let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, the door is still open for salvation. Whosoever will, the door is still open for cleansing. Whosoever will, the door is still open for you to get ready. And whosoever will, the door is still open to get for you to get sanctified, ready for the coming of the Lord. Whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. Rise up and let's come to the Lord and say, Lord, I will. I want to take that water of life freely. The retreat is coming to an end. If you've not been born again, give yourself to the Lord. Repent of your sin. Turn away from every form of evil and trust Jesus, who died for you on the cross of Calvary. If you're a backslider and you have not been restored, this is the time to say, I come with all my heart, all my soul, all my mind. All the things that tied me down, I reject them. I'm going to have this heaven. I'm going to have the grace to get to heaven. I'll be present. You're a believer, you're a child of God, and you want to tell the Lord, oh Lord, nothing will stop me, will stop my journey. I will not stop the journey halfway. All the things, unessential, unimportant things, all the superficial things that held your interest before, get rid of them and press on towards that heavenly home.